Below the forest canopy of North Idaho, thousands of deer fawns are being born each spring. They are part of a 5-year study into the unseen drama between predator and prey and the landscape they share. Idaho Fish and Game, the University of Idaho, and the University of Montana are engaged in a large, multi-species study with white-tailed deer fawns at its core.
We're looking at white-tailed deer fawn survival from their first day of life.
We want to understand survival, so the percent of them that survive into become yearlings really affects the population dynamics.
What we're hoping to find is what limits white-tailed deer populations. If that's habitat quality, which would be a bottom-up factor, or if that's predation, which would be more of a top-down factor.
The end goal of the multi-species study is to better understand how population changes of one species affects other species. But first, it's all about collecting the data.
I got two collars.
White-tailed deer are an extremely understudied species in the Northwest. So that means that all of the information that we're gathering is new.
It's day 20 for graduate student Lorena Carey and crew to find newborn fawns in Game Management Unit 10A, which covers nearly 1 million acres.
It's generally pretty tough. They can be in any type of landscape.
Yeah, we gotta get across there. Yeah.
They can be in kind of open areas. They can be in older forests. They're in bogs, they're in brushy, like, forests. And when you get into some of those latter kind of habitat types with dense brush or thick vegetation, can be really hard to find them and see them.
I wonder if we want to find some higher ground.
The does are stashing these fawns so that they're not detectable, and that sure makes them hard to detect for us too.
Fawns have the home field advantage, but the researchers are armed with sophisticated technology to give them an edge.
131. Yeah.
This past winter, pregnant does were captured and fitted with GPS collars and an implant called a VIT, or VIT.
I found a VIT.
When a fawn is born, the doe expels the VIT, which then sends the location of the birth site.
Let's take a point of the birth site.
Through the doe's satellite collar to the researchers.
What she does is she tries to erase all evidence that she gave birth by cleaning up the birth site.
And this is where the crew begins their search for the newborn fawn.
Generally, you start close to the VIT site, but in a lot of cases, the doe might have moved those fawns out there 100 meters, which is not a long distance in most cases, but in this country with this kind of terrain, it is pretty challenging. You can look for a fawn for a couple of hours and think to yourself, it's time to move on. But for the most part, we want to stay there and search that area really, really well before we move on.
After scouring a large area around the birth site, and with a little luck, today they find their fawn.
They're very small, they hold very still, they're very quiet, and a lot of times when you do see them, you're surprised that you got that close, and you never saw that fawn until you were 3 feet away.
8.36. Once we find the fawn, then it's time to do some measurements and data collection.
25.7.
We do kind of just general characteristics. Yeah, and then we put a collar on them because then we want to be able to track them. The fawn collar ties into the doe collar so that if and when the fawn does die, then we should receive a notification, and then we can go out and do a necropsy on that particular fawn that's died and find out what killed it and if there was any underlying causes, because it's not only just predation, it's also, you know, what made that animal susceptible to predation. Was it malnourished? Did it have poor body condition? Did it have parasites? So we don't just, you know, stop at sort of, okay, a cougar killed it. We probe a little bit further to find out if there was underlying causes.
Once fawns are collared, the collection of data begins that will feed Lorena's research and her piece to understanding whitetail fawn survival.
So my piece is looking at sort of bottom-up effects on white-tailed deer population. And so when we talk about bottom-up effects, it means we need to understand how much nutrition is out there on the landscape. And we do that by kind of like actually kind of calculating like what volume of food is essentially available to these animals. And then we can build sort of a map, if you will, of the nutritional landscape.
Farther north, in Unit 6, Elizabeth Painter with the University of Montana is also collaring and tracking fawns.
So we do daily monitoring on young fawns for the first about 6 weeks when they're most vulnerable to predation. The data that we gain from this interaction between the doe collar and the fawn collar gives us information on how far away the doe is from the fawn and what her behavior is during this time period when she's nursing and cleaning the fawns and spreading them out, and then also on mortality.
The two graduate students collect the same data, but Elizabeth is asking a different set of questions.
My angle is looking at the predators that use white-tailed deer as a resource. So what is the main source of predation on white-tailed deer, both at the adult level as well as neonates?
She's here.
But the likelihood of fawn survival is not necessarily very good. So the causes of fawn mortality are really what we try to understand the most. And we try to get to a fawn mortality within 24 hours to really be able to investigate the true cause. There are a number of different reasons that fawns can die. One of them includes accidents, and then there's predation events, which include black bears and bobcats, which are two species that key in very well on fawns, in addition to coyotes. And we kind of use fawn survival as a metric for how well the population is doing and where they might be vulnerable.
While Elizabeth and Lorena are focused on whitetail fawns,
okay, now do that again.
Other researchers
walk but lean down.
Are using game cameras and collars to track wolves,
be the wolf,
bears, mountain lions, moose, elk, and mule deer in the same game management units.
So all of these species influence each other, and the interactions between multiple predators and multiple prey are complex. Predators don't just influence prey populations, they also influence other predator populations. And prey populations don't just influence the plant communities, they also influence other prey populations. This creates a complex web of interactions, and that's the reason that we need to study all of these species at the same time. For example, if we increase the harvest on mountain lions, will that result in an increase in the number of deer, or will the other predators in the system focus more of their attention on deer and therefore negate any effect that we have of fewer lions? So overall, the goal is to use this improved understanding of these interactions so that we can more effectively and more efficiently achieve our management goals for these species.